40 years ago, a woman just didn't speak out like they do nowadays. But boy, I have learned. Have I ever learned?
The more I needed, the less you gave.
A woman was the token bit thrown in the middle of about four or five guys on a lineup of talent. And now we got our own show.
You never would listen.
I think women have in country music have really come up. I mean, they're really very strong. They're powerful. And they have powerful messages.
But if you think I won't go, watch me.
Now you've had several women that are selling platinum, and that really gets the attention of these record companies.
You don't even know you lost me.
I really see this as a strong time for women to make a point.
Oh, just watch me walk away.
How could anybody ever say it's a man's world? Hey, a woman's got it by the tail.
So, somebody count it.
One, ready? Two, three.
Everything we got the hard way.
When this project came along, it was the most exciting thing to me that's come down the turnpike in the last 15 years.
You ready, Bill? We have speed.
I think we've got the best crop of new singers now. This era we're talking about, than they've had in a long time.
Country music has changed a lot. There's a whole new breed. There's been a turnover.
The reason that it's happening for us today is because of our idols, people like Tammy Wynette and Loretta Lynn, Patsy Montana, Patsy Cline, people that have paved the way for us to be here today. Hopefully, by us being here, it won't be as hard as for the next generation.
The women are making such brave and compelling music, and it's so unusual that all of these women artists are literally in the same place at the same time. It feels very nurturing.
That's an event to me, and it's worth everything.
Coffee. job and not one raise in pay. Now she's in the typing pool at minimum wage.
We would not have the opportunity to go out and do what we do in our generation of women in country music if these women hadn't been out there as the only woman in a gang of men paving the way for us. That especially makes me feel like part of a heritage.
Women just wasn't in the entertainment business. They stayed home and had kids and tended to the house things.
We were not quite accepted as musicians because we were women.
Well, you know, back in the 1920s, it was just not acceptable for a female to be independent, especially not to be alone out on the road. So she was usually relegated to working within the confines of a family group.
It had to be a family. Because the girl carried a bad name if she wasn't with some member of her family.
You did not sing about drinking or out dancing or having a good... It was mainly the old songs.
From the early family groups came our first female stars. Now, the Carter family gave us a couple of the best ever, and that was Sarah and Maybelle.
And I remember coming in from milking the cows, this is the truth, and I turned on the radio and I heard somebody singing Keep on the Sunny Side. And I thought it was the greatest sound, and I thought they were wonderful, so I wanted to know all about the Carter family.
Mother Maybelle Carter and Aunt Sarah Carter were probably the first two truly liberated women that I've ever known or come in contact with. I don't think they really realized what they were doing. They sang for the love of singing. They were both very talented. Mother Maybelle was a perfectionist with the music she played. She played this unique style of guitar where she played the melody with her thumb and then filled in all the other parts with the rest of her fingers that flew like wildfire.
The thing about my grandmother that I remember the most is that she had a wonderful sense of humor and she loved what she did so much.
It was real folk music at its best. The fact that they were really playing music that had been handed down through generations. There was something even very spiritual about how they sounded, even when they sang secular songs. So much power in their voices and in the simplicity of their music. And of course, in Maybelle's playing. I think it also brought me back in touch with my roots of being from the rural South. So without even realizing it, I think I was sort of relating to something that was deep in my blood.
Your loving hand in mine.
You are a stranger
and you're a friend of mine.
Oh, I'll get up round her.
Let a working girl lay down.
I'll get up round her.
Let a working girl lay down.
Our first female stars in country music were actually just cast members of the radio barn dance halls like Renfro Valley or the Grand Ole Opry. We had Lulu Bell at WLS in Chicago, Cousin Emmy at WSB down in Atlanta, Coon Creek Girls at the Renfro Valley Barn Dance in Kentucky, Sunshine Sue was at the Old Dominion Barn Dance, and at the Grand Ole Opry, there was Minnie Pearl.
Now I've got a man and a bulldog too. My man don't fight, but my bulldog do. I'm jealous, jealous hearted me. I'm just a jealous as I can be.
Back in those days, you went to a radio station, you worked a couple years, and you worked the dates that showed the towns around that you could drive to every night and get back in for your morning program.
It wasn't just this particular artist or that particular artist. It was a show. It was a combined show together as a barn dance.
It was all just the folk songs and the spirituals, the hymns and the real mountain songs, you know.
Home to my mother, she and dear, then the others take me home.
The Grand Ole Opry became the longest-running radio show in history, and still is. And the early Opry stars that were women specialized in songs that were like nostalgic and kind of sentimental. They were called heart songs.
Could I tell you once again somehow? Have I told with all my heart and soul how I adore you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now.
Of course, I grew up singing a lot of those folk type songs, you know, and a lot of them were heart songs, you know, and that's the type of song that I sang back when I first started recording.
I think those kind of songs are what country music is really made up of. They tell about the heart and soul of people and the feelings that they went through and the experiences that they had, and that's why a lot of the real old songs are very sad. The tearjerker, you know, kind of songs.
I think about the songs that really tear me apart, and they're songs that really I hear and I go, wow, how did they know that about me? Or, you know, that really make me feel what they're saying and make me believe what they're saying. And those are the kind of songs that I look for.
Caught without a ship in this sea of neglect, the one you swore to love is pulling you down. You're in over your head, chilled to the bone by the waters you've tread. Chart a course to land before you drown. Swim to the nearest distant shore. There's only so much your heart can endure. You gave it your best, forgive yourself. You can't hold on anymore. It's not as far. Every heart for itself, swim to the nearest distant shore. He said for you he'd change, then he let you down and watch you take the blame. You're trapped between his lies and the great unknown. You vowed you would not fail, but this ain't success, it's a living hell. There's nothing left to lose, you're already alone. Swim to the there's only so much your heart
first song that I ever learned was Patsy Montana's I Wanna Be a Cowboy's Sweetheart.
I wanna be a cowboy sweetheart. I wanna learn to rope and to ride. I wanna ride o'er the plains and the desert out west of the great divide. I wanna hear the coyotes howling while the sun sinks in the west. I wanna be a cowboy sweetheart. That's the life that I love best.
I never dreamed that cowboy sweetheart would ever click. I wrote it just to have something to sing. A little fast little number. I need a fast little number. But the phenomenal thing about that number, you know, nowadays it can hit overnight. But that number never hit. It just never died. It stayed right in there.
She sold 1 million records, you know, clear back, you know, just out of the Depression time. And really, you know, really put country music on the map.
Country songs that were written were also so descriptive of the way people felt deep inside, so honest and unashamedly bearing their soul, so to speak, you know, musically. So one was a love for the West and what was there, and the other was very personal, but yet very honest music.
Cowboys and cowgirls are really generally very focused on what they do and are and generally very good at what they do. And I think there's a typical admiration that it goes along with that, along with a historical backing. It's the Old West, it's Americanism, you know, that's what it's all about.
Back in those days, you know, you didn't travel alone with boys, you just didn't. So I really think we broke the ice that way of going out with four guys and a gal. In the money situation, they tried to take advantage, pay me less because I was a girl. But I look back and I stood my ground. I wasn't scared of me, I just stood my ground. And I got what I was supposed to get.
I think in order to feel good about what you're doing and to get things done the way that you want them to be, you have to be strong. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. But it does seem to make it difficult when you're working with other people, men, because of the fact that you are hard to work with if you know what you want.
I think there's always been a saying in Nashville that if you're a man and you're aggressive and take care of business, that you're really respected and called very strong. And if you're a woman, they call you something else.
You have to handle it, take it a step at a time, and do the best you can. But you definitely have to toughen up.
I think that's why so many has not survived, is because they wasn't tough enough.
I think that's why there's so many better women entertainers than there are men, in my opinion, right now, because they do have to try harder. They have to work harder at it, and they have to give more to get the same result, to get the same paycheck, you know? And then their paycheck is still less, so. So heaven help the working girl in a world that's run by men.
Everybody is just sort of empathetic with each other because we know that we all work really hard and we all have a passion for this thing, this music that we make.
I've adopted Susie Boggess for two or three reasons. First reason, she rejuvenated Cowboy Sweetheart, and she does a great job. She really yodels, and she's got a good voice, and I don't know what could stop her. Anyway, I've adopted her as my other. I've got an adopted daughter now. I think she's great. I'll make her pay me for that.
Said to me, I ain't being what I'm supposed to be. Well, I don't know, it could be true. I know I wasn't always there. Don't let this be the reason. to do. I've never understood that part of you. You know I tried to be a friend, but you feel undermined and hurt again.
First grew up listening to the radio and listening to Texas Daisy and Texas Ruby, Patsy Montana and the Carter family, Sarah and Maybelle Carter, and there weren't too many girls in the business at the time, and that was about the, you know, stint of the women in the country field.
The first woman star I ever remember hearing was Kitty Wells singing Honky Tonk Angel.
I remember seeing pictures of her and seeing her on television shows and stuff, and she played guitar. That was the separator between women that sang other kinds of music and country music. The girl singers in country music took up a guitar and played just like a man would play for himself.
World War II came along, and the big dance halls came up, and all big bands, Western swing bands like that, was making a killing at country music.
There'll be some sad singing and some slow riding the next time you come staggering in. There'll be some cold.
I was in the honky-tonk era along with Kitty Wells and Rose Maddox. Back in my heyday, there was no room to be a wimp. You had to stand up for what you, you know, and kind of fight for what we got.
Honky-tonk scene was, well, it got a little raunchy at times. Most of the time, let's put it that way. But you had to work them because the working people all went to honky-tonks.
When I think back about the traveling, it scares me to think how many miles we made in such short times.
We just had two-lane highways. We didn't have the super highways and rode in automobiles. And a lot of times, you know, you had the big bass fiddle right inside the car and you had to ride with that around you.
And with that bass fiddle sticking over my neck, with my head bent over this way, you know, and so much so really that I developed arthritis because I had to ride all these miles, you know, riding that hump in that station wagon.
The girls nowadays, they got a lot of better ways to travel, like in the buses, and we've got super highways, and it makes it a lot nicer. But some of them, I don't believe, will have the stamina that some of us artists had when we first started out.
With the conditions they had and the way they were, the road that they were trying to pave, they didn't have much of a choice. They just had to leave their kids for long periods of time.
To be a woman in country music is to be kind of torn between dreams. Family and career are always going to compete for each other.
I do have children, and I took time off the road at one point, but it wasn't because I didn't feel that a woman should have their place there.
I think you need to take them with you. I think a home is only four walls. Home is where you are.
I just couldn't stand to leave them when they were around my legs, and so I quit the business for several years.
It's important to me to do a good job as bringing up my child. I mean, she deserves that. I feel like there's a way to do both.
I had to put my job first when I came to town. It was the only way I could take care of my children. It was the only way I could be happy with myself. And it was the only way that I could do it.
I had a bunch of kids to feed, and I had to work, and I knew I had to work. And when I threw myself into my music, My husband was behind me, and I worked, and there wasn't no place that I didn't work.
These women, you know, pioneered country music. They are country music. Boy, I just hope that I'm worthy to walk a mile in their high heels.
I said away. I said he had a lot of potential. He was only misunderstood. You know, he really didn't mean to treat me so bad. He wanted to be good. And I swore one day I would tame him.
Maddox, Skeeter Davis, Brenda Lee, Wanda Jackson, I think they had a great deal to do with the teen revolution of music in the 1950s. They took the sound of country music and the sound of the rhythm and blues, the beat of the rhythm and blues, and next thing you know, there we had rockabilly.
We walk along hand in hand.
I was one of the first females to come out and compete with the guys in the rock and roll field. At an early age, I got tagged by a nickname called Little Miss Dynamite, which has followed me these many years, and sort of, I guess, was the first female rocker. Wanda Jackson, of course, was in rockabilly and still is a vital force around the world.
At that time, I had never heard the name Elvis Presley. He was getting a name in certain areas, but he hadn't reached Oklahoma yet. But I watched this guy, and he was so fantastic, and we dated when we could, when we were on tour, and we were very good friends. And he said, Wanda, you need to sing this rockabilly, rock and roll music. And I said, well, I love it, but I can't sing it. You know, I'm a country singer. He said, well, I'm a country singer, too. He said, you've got to do it. It's going to be the next big music, and you've got to get in on it.
And now honky-tonky Joe, knocking at the door. The bring him in, fill him up, sit him on the floor. Let's have a party.
We never thought nothing about it. We thought we was just doing plain old country music, you know, except that it did have an upbeat to it and would reach out and grab the people. We mixed a medley of country, western, gospel, whatever it took to entertain the people. I thought all the time that I was just singing my country music, and come to find out I was a rockabilly star and didn't know it.
The rockabilly attitude is sort of an edginess, a little edge to it, a little bit, some of it's a little bit angry.
I didn't like the cowboy boots image and having to stand still. I always wanted to move around and get some excitement, and the buzzword these days is energy.
I like to move around on stage, I always have. I always felt very motivated to move. And when my music moves me, I feel like moving and can't really stand still.
Tanya adored Elvis. I slipped him in one time to see her and didn't let her know because I thought it'd just make her go all to pieces. And he made the remark, he said, well, you know, May, she's kind of a female Elvis Presley.
But it's a little too late. Well, it's a little too late. When you walked in, I should have walked out. But it's a little too late to do the right thing now. Well, the whole town told me you're a heartbreak king. Guess I ought to pay attention when they say those things. But it's a little too late. Well, it's a little too late. I know all my old buddies wanna help me out, but it's a little too late to do the right thing now. Turn the jukebox up, throw some sawdust down. I'm too far gone to turn this heart around. But it's a little too late. But it's a little too late. When you walked in, I should have walked out. But it's a little too late to do the right thing now. I may be wrong, but I don't want out. But it's a little too late to do the right thing now.
Yes, I lost my little darling the night they were playing the beautiful Tennessee Waltz.
When Patti Page sang the Tennessee Waltz, she pointed the way to a whole new style in country music.
By the 1950s, they had called it the Nashville Sound. It was smooth and it was sweet. It was a perfect blend of pop music arrangements and the great country music lyrics.
Country was making that transition from, quote, hillbilly for so long, you know, which men fit into that role, I think, better than women.
When I came here, first of all, I had to write for men because men were your basic artists.
We were told that songwriting was a closed operation. You're not going to get in. The boys won't let you in. And I thought, baloney.
Women weren't supposed to know anything about the business. Women weren't supposed to have that many artistic ideas.
There were probably a lot of great women's songs floating around, but they didn't have the right connections to get anywhere.
We were told women didn't sell. And I couldn't believe it then, because there was Peggy Lee, there was Patti Page, there was Joni James. What are they talking about?
Probably the woman who embodied the Nashville Sound more than anyone was Patsy Cline. Absolutely.
Now someone else will hold you just the way I used to do. How can I face tomorrow when I know I'm losing you?
The cry and the catch in the voice was genuine, and it was part of her deal. You believed what she sang? You believed the emotion that she was talking about? She had a style that was all her own, still is.
She could sing it country, she could sing it pop, she could yodel, she could do anything with her voice she wanted to and do it perfection.
One night, I had just finished listening to her sing and I went in to change clothes and the door flew open and in walked Patsy. And she had on this cowgirl outfit with the fringe and the boots and stood there with her hands on her hips and she said, "Well, you're a conceited little SOB. You just waltz in here and do your spot and do your song and waltz out." And she says, "You don't say hello, kiss my foot or anything to anybody." And I said, "Now wait just a minute. When a newcomer comes to town, it's the people that live there that make them feel welcome. They ain't a damn soul made me feel welcome here." And boy, she backed up and she laughed. When she laughed from here, you know, all the way up, and you could hear her a block away. She says, "You know, you all right, honey." I said, anybody that'll talk back to the client is all right. She says, "And we're gonna be good friends."
I think Patsy was probably the first strong-headed woman in country music. It was like, she is not gonna take nothing off nobody. And I think we all admire that in Patsy. But there was a soft side of Patsy, too, that came out in the ballads, which I think we all would like for people to read us, I think, the way we read Patsy.
I'm looking for something in there, something that's shocking to turn someone's head. Strapless and sequined and cut down to there. Stockings and garters and lace underwear. The guaranteed number to knock a man dead. I'm looking for something red. Looking for something in white, something that shimmers in soft candlelight. Everyone calls us the most perfect pair. Should I wear a veil or a rose in my hair? Where the train must be long and waist must be tight. I'm looking for something white. I'm looking for then real tiny, the baby's brand new. He has his father's nose and his chin. We once were hard lovers, now we're more like friends. Don't tell me that's just what I'm married for. Something new. I'm looking for something in red, like the one that I wore when I first turned his head. Strapless and sequins and cut down to just a size larger than I wore last year. The guaranteed number to knock the man dead. I'm looking for something. I gotta have something. I'm looking for something in red.
Years ago, a woman just didn't speak out like they do nowadays. But boy, I have learned. Have I ever learned?
The more I needed, the less you gave.
A woman was the token bit thrown in the middle of about four or five guys on a lineup of talent. And now we got our own show.
You never would listen.
I think women have in country music have really come up. I mean, they're really very strong. They're powerful. And they have powerful messages.
But if you think I won't go, watch me.
Now you've had several women that are selling platinum, and that really gets the attention of these record companies.
You don't even know you lost me.
I really see this as a strong time for women to make a point.
Oh, just watch me walk away.
How could anybody ever say it's a man's world? Hey, a woman's got it by the tail.
So, somebody count it.
One, ready? Two, three.
Everything we got the hard way.
When this project came along, it was the most exciting thing to me that's come down the turnpike in the last 15 years.
You ready, Bill? We have speed.
I think we've got the best crop of new singers now in this area we're talking about than they've had in a long time.
Country music has changed a lot. There's a whole new breed. There's been a turnover.
The reason that it's happening for us today is because of our idols, people like Tammy Wynette and Loretta Lynn, Patsy Montana, Patsy Cline, people that have paved the way for us to be here today. Hopefully, by us being here, it won't be as hard as for the next generation.
The women are making such brave and compelling music, and it's so unusual that all of these women artists are literally in the same place at the same time. It feels very nurturing. That's an event to me, and it's worth everything.
I started noticing a difference in our crowd in the middle 50s. They were doctorates from Georgetown University. some guy said, y'all playing some folk songs? Daddy said, well, I guess it is folk music. We're folks, ain't we? I won't forget that.
The folk revival in the 60s gave a whole new life to the traditional performers of country music.
It was really exciting because they thought basically they were forgotten about, and it wasn't the case. And their music still lives on today. I got a man.
It was the first time that I realized the impact my grandmother had had on music. My grandmother came on stage and they introduced her, and she walked out and she didn't say a word or touch an instrument, and she got a standing ovation.
She said, I can't believe this. And they would come up and say, can we just touch you? You know, to our mother.
Touch mother.
And so I thought it was just really beautiful, you know, that they did that.
Well, the folk era was wonderful for dragging up a lot of those old songs that all of us could sit around and sing and play.
I think so much of folk music, and that's a term that's very hard to define nowadays also, but I think that is music with a conscience.
The person that comes to mind to me immediately is Joan Baez. And I think because of Joan's strength in what she had to say as well, she was not just a musician, she was a spokesperson for the generation. And I think that was very valuable for a woman to be in that role.
The women of that folk revival were the first women to really step out and make their feelings known in their music and in production.
Listening to Judy Collins and Joni Mitchell and, you know, the words and the melodies were so important at that time.
And country music, it seems to be the last place that you can hear the lyrics. And you can remember them, and you can even sit down if you'd like and play them.
For me, the joy is finding the ones that really have something to say. And those are the ones that live on for me night after night after night. And when I get really, really lucky, I find one that keeps teaching me a lesson over and over again every night when I sing it, according to what's going on in my own life.
I could count on, I could count on one hand, with a leftover finger or two. I took them for granted, let them all slip away. Now where they are, I wish I knew. I guess we never learn. We go through life parched and empty, standing knee deep in a river and dying of thirst. Sometimes I remember sweethearts I've known. Some I've forgotten, I suppose. One or two still linger. Oh, I wonder now why I ever let them go. They're all by, just like water. And I guess we never. The city goes by, and I rush through another day, and a world full of strangers. turn their eyes to me, I just look the other way.
Dottie West was one of the most fascinating people I've ever known. In fact, Dottie tried to encourage me to move to Nashville before I did, and I remember one time I said, Dottie, I don't know enough yet to move to Nashville. I'm not ready. And she said, Jeannie, where do you think you learn it? You learn in Nashville.
You see evidence of her, what she left us today, and people like Steve Warner and Larry Gatlin, and helping them get their careers, you know, on their way. I mean, Mom was just good at recognizing the talent, and maybe if it helped to buy him a plane ticket to town or something, you know, if that's what it took, then she would do that. She would reach out.
In the 1960s, there were three women that came along and changed everybody's idea about what a woman country music star was about. Loretta, Dolly, and Tammy. They don't need last names.
Loretta Lynn certainly came along and just said it. I mean, she just spit it out exactly the way she saw it.
You either have to be first, great, or different in this business to make it. And I was the first to ever go into Nashville telling it like it was and singing it like the women lived it.
And I can't equate anybody else with somebody like Loretta Lynn. And it's almost like that song that Maria Muldaur did with the jug band. You know, I'm a woman, you know, I can go in and cook my man up some grits, and then I can kiss him and give him the shiver and fits because I'm a woman, you know, we do it all.
When I first came to Nashville, I would be on stage and realize in the middle of a song I was singing on the same show as Loretta Lynn, and I'd just forget my words and just have to quit and start over.
She came to town with twice the amount of kids I came to town with. So I don't know how in the world she made it. And she did a lot of driving in a car with her kids in the car and Mooney. So it was very tough for her. And I just think she's been a very spunky lady to have hung in there like she has.
Jolene, Jolene, Jolene.
I don't think there's a better singer nor writer anywhere than Dolly. I think she's as talented as anyone I have ever known, anyone I've ever met.
And Dolly's a genius. She's a very bright, smart businesswoman, as well as a great performer and a great entertainer. And she's probably one of my very favorite songwriters.
I was lucky enough to get to sing on her new record. And I was probably 2 feet away from her. She started singing and my eyes just, you know, filled up with tears, and I turned into this basket case because, you know, that's what heaven sounds like. Dolly Parton singing is what heaven sounds like.
I remember the first time I heard Tammy sing, and my mouth just fell open.
She just always looked so perfect and sang so great, and I could remember thinking someday when I grow up, that's what I want to be.
Our D-I-V-O-R-C-E becomes final today.
It seemed like the older I got, the more her older songs meant to me. And I definitely have to say she was my biggest role model. Of course, there's always Loretta and Patsy, but Tammy's the one that really stuck out in my mind.
Well, all of these ladies are still on the road and still vital forces in country music. In fact, this year marks Tammy Wynette's 25th anniversary of being a superstar.
I'll never let you see the way my broken heart is hurting me. I've got my pride, and I know how to hide all the sorrow and pain. I'll do my crying in the rain. If I wait for cloudy skies, you won't know the rain from the tears in my eyes. You'll never know that I still love you so, though the heartaches remain. I'll do my crying in the rain. Someday when my crying's done, I'm gonna wear a smile and walk in the sun. I may be a fool, but till then, darling, you never see me complain. I'll do my crying in the rain. I'll do my crying in the rain. I'll do my crying in the rain.
Decade in the 70s, between the 70s and 80s, opened a lot of doors for a lot of women to transition from being a girl singer, quote unquote, to going out there and trying to put your own band together and run three or four or six guys up and down the road and be the boss. It was tough.
Women were still in 75 to be seen and not heard. You were to be the chick singer in the male singer's band.
Back then, you know, I don't think there were any record company executives that were women. We didn't have song pluggers that were women, and we certainly didn't have any women in production of records.
Now shine on the sunshine, welcome the world, it's a skippity-doo-da-day. I'm the happiest girl in the whole USA.
I've seen a real evolution of the role of the woman in country music, and I think it's primarily because of the female writers. I think there's been an attitude in a lot of songs from a long time ago that, well, honey, you can go off and swing around with whoever you want to, and I'll just stay here with the kids at home and be here when you get home. But I think there came a time in country music where, you know, we all just said, we're not like that. We're just as important as you are.
I see other people come along and have smash hits they're not quite prepared for. The hit itself puts them into an image that maybe they're not comfortable with. I was in a miniskirt because I was told to be. I even showed up at the CMA Awards in 1968. the evening I received the single of the year for Harper Valley PTA, I had designed myself a French Marie Antoinette that would layer after layer hit the ground in a beautiful, huge dress. And I went to pick my dress up, and it only had four or five little short layers that stopped just below panty line. I said, "What is that?" My dressmaker said, "Your producer said if you showed up in anything but a mini skirt, he'd have my job." Well, it didn't matter that I was paying for the dress.
I know that Jeannie Seely was very instrumental in getting the Opry to stop introducing the women as here comes cute little lady in a cute little dress, or here comes pretty little gal sings a cute little song.
Turn it around. Wouldn't it sound silly if you said, here's a good-looking little guy, you know, got on a real pretty suit with rhinestones all over it, and it's awful.
Someone asked us one day, they said, well, are you card-carrying feminists? And it's like, well, actions speak louder than words.
Feminism is a word that's been kicked around for so long that I don't think if you asked 100 people what that word meant, you'd get 100 different answers.
I didn't like the militancy of it, but as I've become older, I've really become very understanding of that. Because unless we really make a fuss sometimes, nobody's gonna listen.
Women are so important in country music because a man can't write a song from our point of view.
We have different perspectives, and I do believe that it comes out, you know, in different ways.
I think that the producers and the record labels realize that women can write great songs. They realize that the audience is largely female. They realize that women can speak for other women very well.
The women in my songs tend to be fairly strong. They hurt, they cry, they get left, but they handle it. And they also retaliate.
It's not all truck driving and beer drinking and cheating, you know. It's issues that really matter in the world today. And I think that that's a very positive thing because the voice of country music is being listened to today.
Now this next song is not a man-bashing song. It's just a guideline for all you fellas out there. Take it like a man.
What you guess.
I keep looking for a friend and a lover. When I find one, he ain't the other. Sometimes I just wanna quiz. One wants a mate, one needs his mother. They either want space or they wanna smother me. And my poor heart needs somebody who can take it like a man. I can ride in store. Singing like a man who knows about love and every little thing that a girl dreams of. Someone wise enough to understand. If you want this woman's heart, sing it like a man. I met somebody the other night. He was Mr. Right or Wrong. I might have never known. If a friend then brought it to my attention, he's got a wife he forgot to mention. Girl, leave that fool alone. I keep hoping and telling myself somewhere there's one, a good one left. 'Cause my this morning.
When I first came into country music around 1979, previous to that time, women almost always were singing songs from a victim perspective. And I think that some of us who came in at the very beginning of the urban cowboy phase were trying to break away from that archetype.
I think Emmy is a true heart. She chooses her music from the heart, and she sings from the heart. And she really did appreciate the traditional roots of country and apply them in her own soulful, unique way.
Emmy Lou Harris, without a doubt, was my biggest female inspiration, because when I saw her, when I heard her, I was drawn back to country music.
Emmy Lou Harris and Linda Ronstadt had everybody's attention. They were young women who reflected both the respect for tradition with the rock music that was happening at the time, and it made for some really great music.
I passed you on the street, and my heart felt your feet. I can't help it, I'm still in love with you.
The first thing that I remember about hearing Lena Ronstadt was hearing that voice. There was a power and an emotion, and you believed every single word she said, and I had not heard that ever before.
She just has that thing in her voice. She's got soul that made me believe everything she was singing.
You feel like you've been through a drama in a 3-minute song.
As far as I'm concerned, Linda Ronstadt should be in the Hall of Fame. Emmy should be in the Hall of Fame, because the country rock music that we have today is what they hatched way back when.
The vast differences between men and women that are being explored by artists like Roseanne Cash, and Mary Chapin, and people that are, these women that are writing lyrics that I think only a woman, could only come from a woman's heart.
Today, when I look at the audience out there and I see the women out there, it gives me an opportunity to give to them lyrically when I'm singing, or to let them have the freedom within a song. It's like, hey, this is me she's singing about. And that's what I love to see on their faces, them getting into the music.
Really?
having it for him. Now look at everybody trying to be what I was then. I was country when country was uncool.
I remember that my sister Barbara looked different than anybody else in country music at the beginning of the 80s, but she was honest, and I think that's what you have to be in country music. Don't be something you're not. Don't pretend. It's never going to work. You can't fool the people.
She ended up appealing to a young audience with some of the songs. She didn't need to follow the cheating thing. You know, she didn't have to do that. There was a lot more to her than that.
Once women started selling platinum and our concerts were sellouts, then we started getting the attention and the respect that we deserved.
Well, the 80s was really the decade when women took charge. They took control of their careers and they defined their own images. They commanded respect and they got it. They had no problem saying, this is how I want my lights to be and this is how I want my PA to be.
This is what I want done for me. This is my career and this is how I would like it to be done.
Rather than be victim heroines, we wanted to be self-actualizing heroines, and we wanted to say that with our music.
For quite a few years, it was just like, if you ain't in your 20s anymore, then you're over the hill. And that's a bunch of bull now. You know, it doesn't hold true. K.T. Austin proved that you can bust out on the scene and sell in your mid-40s and sell records.
That has always made me the happiest when I feel that I have really written something that people genuinely connect with. Not just a chant, you know, hey, baby, baby, I love you, you know. Yeah, we've heard that one. But they go, you wrote my life. You wrote something that I actually lived. That's cool.
One of the girls that comes to mind that has helped me so much is Reba McEntire. I can't tell you the time she's talked to me and she's hugged my neck and you know, just been like a big sister.
I find other women in the country music business to be, it seems like we're all kind of sisters. You know, me being a newcomer, I think they have that feeling, that inclination to take you under their wing, and you just feel like family.
There's something that happens when women get into a room together. We bypass a lot of the BS and go straight to things of the heart.
Even sitting in there today with the girls, I felt like I could go out there and do anything.
Jimmy climbs on board that old yellow bus. It sure looks big in his little eyes. His mama waits as her tears kick up the dust. It's never easy to say goodbye. Wedding gown has found her wings and it's time to fly. It's all her dad can do to keep from breaking down. It's never easy to say goodbye. Ways. And it's all right if you wanna cry. someday. It's never easy to say bye.
Someday. Thank you.
Everything we got the heart.
We're developing, I think, quite a support group among ourselves.
We've been through children, we've been through marriages, divorces, deaths in the family. And it seems like the women just kind of grow and rely on each other's friendship.
You know, when you share the same dreams and goals and you face the same problems, there has to be a sisterhood.
Gosh, we're all feeling the same feelings, going through the same things, having the same doubts, same fears, same joys. And it was really wonderful, a wonderful experience to be in a room with all these other women entertainers. It was just a real affirming experience.
I want to continue to bring into this music business creative freedom. I want to be able to go into that studio and spill my guts and for no one to stand there and say, oh, I'm sorry, you can't do that because that's way out of line.
If you really have that talent, if you really have that drive, you will go on and do it no matter what anybody says.
You just gotta be really determined and know exactly what you want and just be a really go-getter to, you know, make things happen for yourself, because there are some things that can be very discouraging.
The only thing I've had to fall back on is my music, and that does it every time. So it's something from within me that keeps me going. I can't do without my music.
We've always had a lot of integrity in our music, and I think that that's what really the listeners are responding to.
There's a brand new audience out there that we didn't touch, we couldn't reach when we were first singing, when we first came to town 25 years ago. And that audience is very young and very enthusiastic.
They might like rap, but they still want to like get a little heartstring pulled. And that's what we're here for.
You know, country fans, they say, don't ever retire. Just keep on singing. So I just tell them, as long as our health holds out, we're going to keep out there singing.
As far as the future of country music, hopefully it's always going to maintain. That key word is always going to be country.
It's not just as simplistic as, well, my guy left me and now I'm sitting in a bar playing the jukebox. You know, the issues are edgier, more compelling. The music to me is very brave and interesting. And to me, that's real life. And that's what makes me want to listen to the music. That's what makes me want to seek it out.
Show the things that drew me to you and stole my.
Chapin